Hello and welcome to this RSA conference virtual session, DevSecOps is a global movement, APJ included. I am your host, Erica Shubin of RSA Conference. During the session, all participants will be in listen-only mode. At the close of the presentation, we will conduct a question and answer session. Throughout the presentation, if you have a question, please use the chat feature, which is located in the lower left corner of your screen. As a reminder, this session is being recorded. Following the session, you will receive a follow-up email containing a link to the video replay. The replay will also be posted to rsaconference.com. Today's presenters are Alan Shimel, Editor-in-Chief and Founder of DevOps.com and Security Boulevard, Mark Miller, Senior Storyteller Sonotype and Co-Founder DevSecOps Days and All Day DevOps, and DJ Schleen, DevSecOps Evangelist and Security Architect in the healthcare sector. I would now like to turn it over to Alan to begin the session.
Good day, everyone. Thanks for joining us. Erica, thanks for the introduction. Welcome to what I think is going to be a great discussion today around DevSecOps, which is really a global phenomenon that, you know, we at DevOps.com and Security Boulevard are seeing just taking hold from the U.S. to Europe to China to Singapore to the Asia-Pacific region, South America, Middle East, Africa. It is everywhere DevOps is, and, of course, security is. It seems DevSecOps is as well. I want to just quickly introduce what I think is a great panel for today. Both of these gentlemen are truly DevSecOps experts. First of all, I want to introduce my compadre, my co-host, my partner in bringing DevSecOps around the world, whether it be at RSA San Francisco, RSA APJ, or London, or Bangkok, or Australia, or anywhere else. Mark Miller, who is a co-founder of DevSecOps Days, as well as All Day DevOps, Senior Storyteller Sonotype. Mark, welcome. Just want to make sure you hear me.
Yeah, Alan, thanks for the intro. I didn't realize we were so ubiquitous around the world already.
Well, we're trying. And then joining us also is, look, one of my heroes in the DevSecOps space. I first saw him present at RSA San Francisco about 2 years ago at our DevSecOps event. He was kind enough to come back this year in San Francisco and really knock the room dead with his insight and knowledge around DevSecOps. And, you know, for those of you who are listening who will be in Singapore for RSA APJ, he'll also be presenting at DevSecOps Days there on July 24th. None other than DJ Schleen, DevSecOps Evangelist and Security Architect. DJ, welcome.
Hey, Alan. Thanks for inviting me over to participate in this conference. And Mark, good to see you guys again. And looking forward to getting over to Singapore and telling the story and how we're automating the healthcare industry.
Great. Okay, let's jump right into it because we have a lot to cover and not a heck of a lot of time. I want to start off with just a couple of kind of public service announcements. You may have heard me use the term DevSecOps Days now a few times, and Mark's a co-founder of it. DevSecOps Days is a community movement. It's a worldwide movement. And the idea is, you know, kind of patterned after the very popular and successful DevOps Days, sort of on conferences, as well as for us in the security world, the Security B-Sides conferences, which have been wildly successful. DevSecOps Days is in that same vein. Mark, John Willis, myself are kicking off some of the initial ones, but we're really looking for the community to run with this and start holding DevSecOps Days around the world. So I encourage you all off front to check out DevSecOpsDays.com. There's a lot of resources there, information on upcoming events, and how you can get involved in bringing an event to your local area. So DevSecOpsDays.com if you get a chance, folks. And Mark curates and maintains the site, so he can tell you more about it. And then also, as I mentioned earlier, we are coming to APJ, and why not, you know, Asia-Pacific region, Japan, even China. I've recently been there. You know, DevSecOps is top of mind there, as is DevOps and security. So we will be, for our second year at DevSec, at RSA Conference APJ, at the Singapore Convention Center at the beautiful Mandalay Bay. We are there July 24th, which is the day before the actual keynotes, conference, and exhibits open. You can register for RSA APJ, and that registration will get you into DevSecOps Days. I'll also invite everyone listening who might be attending to join us after our event on the 24th at our DevSecOps Wining, not Wining, cocktail party, which is kind of a tradition. Mark and I have now been doing that for 4 or 5 years in San Francisco, and this will be the second year in Singapore. So please join us there. You can get more information at the RSA conference site. All right. With that out of the way, you know, like many things in DevOps and DevSecOps, we point back to, you know, Gene Kim's kind of seminal work, the Phoenix Project, where we emphasize performance of the entire system and never pass a defect downstream. With that, I you know, that's kind of a guiding principle for DevSecOps. And DJ, before I move on to kind of the difference between DevOps and DevSecOps, I just wanted to give you and Mark a chance to comment on that.
Absolutely. You know, when you start looking at security and how it relates to DevOps, it's just a natural addition. When we look at the quality of our applications that are going out to our consumers, and when we look at all the steps to get that product out to the consumers, having security involved and having quality checks from a security perspective inside of that development pipeline, it's extremely important. And you know, as we start going through talking about DevSecOps, talking about DevOps in general, you know, we have to really be cognizant of the flow and the application going through that pipeline. So, you know, you never want to pass a defect downstream, you never want it. If you know about it, you never want it to go to production. That's the main thing.
Sure.
DJ, also,
Mark, any
mm-hmm. Yeah, DJ presented in San Francisco for RSAC. One of the slides that you had, DJ, was indicative of this. It's when you did the complete build of an entire pipeline, and you inserted security at every step along the way within the pipeline. That was one of the most powerful slides of that whole session.
Yep. You know, and that's something we really need to start addressing, right? From a security perspective, I think that we're doing the same thing that developers and operational staff are doing. You know, we're investigating, looking for defects. If that happens to be a security vulnerability, it's just something that we have to fix. It might just have a different priority. But there's different kinds of controls that you put along that pipeline, and how you integrate those in gives you information along the way of the quality of your application from a security perspective. And when you blend that in with what's happening from a quality perspective, from your QA, from your development teams, then you have a really good idea of the whole product you have and you know, everything around that, the quality of that product.
Yep. So, guys, let us start this conversation off. I'm going to assume we have some people out here who may not be familiar, frankly, with DevSecOps. They may not even be all that familiar with DevOps. They might have heard the term, but not really familiar. I wanted to start off with sort of a good picture, if you will, of the difference between DevOps and DevSecOps. And you know, in way of credit, I believe this came from Shannon Leitz's site, DevSecOps.org. And Shannon's another person very involved in the DevSecOps organization community, and runs DevSecOps.org, as well as running DevSecOps for Intuit. And I think this is a great kind of picture that gives you the difference between DevOps or DevSecOps. But I want to emphasize, using the word versus here is not necessarily that they're at loggerheads or in competition. I think DevSecOps obviously adds security to the mix of the existing DevOps kind of pattern, if you will. And again, Mark, DG, I realize it's hard being disjointed in three separate places around the world today, but any comments on the difference between DevOps and DevSecOps?
When I look at this diagram, Alan, one of the things, and I'm usually the naysayer and the protagonist in this kind of thing, but one of the things I see here is that I think security needs to be more integrated than just as a triangle here in a Venn diagram. And I wish there was a better way to show it. We're all used to Venn diagrams. They're easy conceptually to get visually. But when we're talking about this, as I refer back to what DJ had had, we have to find a way, not just verbally, but visually show that DevSecOps includes integration throughout all of the other parts of these circles, not just as a touch point in it. I think it needs to be full integration, and we haven't found the right diagram for that yet. DJ?
Yeah, you know, if you're looking at this diagram, you know, DevOps is a precursor, in my opinion, to DevSecOps. DevSecOps is just a natural evolution. And having security, you know, looking at this diagram, I see operations, application, delivery, development, security. If you just layered all those on top of each other and blurred the lines, I think, to me, that's what DevSecOps is. I think we're entering a time where engineers of any sort, whether they're in security or whether they're developers or whether they're QA, everyone has to have a security mindset and an ingrained culture of security in the organization. Everything that we do, everything that we put out into the marketplace from a product perspective is something that we're putting in our consumers' hands, and they trust that it's going to perform the way that we promise it will, and in a secure manner that doesn't compromise any of their personal information. So, you know, there's a bunch of different components that go into this. I agree that the diagrams still haven't found the correct way to describe and visualize what this is. But if you overlaid security into everything here, you know, 100% or whatever it could be, you're going to have that in the back of your head. And when you're developing code, when you're pushing it through production, when you're doing these checks, and I think that that's you know, something we still got to figure out.
Guys, if you allow me, let me go top rope on you here. You know, I firmly believe that DevSecOps is something we use to mollify people who want to see a difference between DevOps and DevSecOps. There is no DevOps without security. There's no DevSecOps without DevOps. They're one and the same. There is only one DevOps. DJ, I think you're hitting it when you say, well, security should cover all these circles. I think that the real nitty-gritty of DevSecOps, folks, is that security is everyone's responsibility. And security needs to be embedded and part of everything we do, whether it be dev or ops or modern ops or app delivery or testing or CICD. Security needs to be part of that. The fact that we need to call it out as a separate discipline, I think is a waypoint along the road of where we're headed, which is security is part of DevOps. Mark, do you have thoughts on that?
Yeah, absolutely. I remember having a conversation with John Willis after RSA DevOps Days and DevOps Connect back in 2017. And, you know, he basically said to me, like, I don't like the term DevSecOps. And I agreed with him. I don't necessarily like the term, but what it does is it calls out the need for security. And, you know, the reason why we don't call it SecDevOps or OpDevSec or, you know, DevOpsSec is basically if you lead with security, people aren't going to follow you. If you follow with security, it's going to be an afterthought. It always has been. And if you put security right in the middle, you're in this sort of sweet spot where it just becomes part of the culture and that foundation of DevOps. So, you know, ideally in a utopian world, DevOps, we would just do security and it would just be part of everything we do on a day-to-day basis. You know, but now that we're at this point where security is becoming a centralized theme in a lot of the work that we do, it really makes sense to call it out separately, but hopefully it will transcend into, you know, one complete cultural aspect of DevOps.
Great.
Mark, what do you think?
I'm good with that. I thought you hit it very well when you said that what we are is in an evolutionary phase. DevOps to DevSecOps, it's just moving through and tying everything together. And we'll see another iteration coming down in 2 to 3 years. There'll be another iteration of it. So we're just part of an evolution.
Very good. All right, guys, if it's okay, let's move on to our next slide here. And so this is an interesting slide, Mark, that I actually lifted, giving full credit to Derek Weeks, who did an amazing presentation at RSA DevSecOps Days. And Derek, of course, is part of the Sona type team with you, Mark. So I'm going to let you address the slide. If it's okay.
Actually, I've got more slides related to this further in this discussion. But what people need to think about right now is who is liable for the security of their data and their systems. And that's a real critical issue because previously, historically, we always put that on the burden of the security team, the one person out of 100 developers who was responsible for security. And it has gone way beyond that now. The company is being held responsible for the liability of their products and for their data and for their systems. And that's why, again, I had to keep referring back to DJ's presentation because he hit it so well. It's everybody's responsibility. DJ?
Absolutely. You know, in organizations that haven't defined a CISO or some kind of executive sponsor for security in the organization, I believe the number has risen to about 82% of organizations have a dedicated CSO or CISO role. But, you know, if they don't have that role in their organization, that ultimate liability comes and rests on the CEO's hands. And they might not be the person to create those strategic programs around the IT security and even physical security and the convergence of those two domains. So everybody from the executives all the way to developers, testers, people who are looking and operating the software to your data engineers, everybody is ultimately responsible for ensuring that there's a context of security involved in what they're doing. And there's a lot of teeth that in regulations that stand behind that, and it's very important for businesses to know that these constraints, these regulations, and these frameworks are out there, and that there's large penalties if you're breached and you release personal healthcare information or any kind of payment information.
Absolutely. Let us, guys, I'm a little concerned with our time, so I'm good, if it's okay, move on. DJ, this is a slide that actually came out of your most recent RSA DevSecOps Days presentation about focusing on risk and the relationship between security, risk, and how it relates to DevOps. But I wanted, it's your slide. I'm not going to put words in your mouth. Why don't you tell our audience, share a little bit?
Well, when you start looking at that end-to-end development pipeline, like the idea and the conceptualization of a product feature all the way out into production, you're really looking at a bunch of different things. And DevSecOps, DevOps is not just CI. If you implement CI and CD, that's not a 100% DevOps implementation. You know, and even in putting these security controls like static code analysis and dynamic analysis, And that's not even DevSecOps. But when you look at the application pipeline itself, when you start doing things like infrastructure as code, security as code, and you start pushing this code into your repositories and automating the processes to deliver any of this code or the application code itself, you're reducing a lot of risk because you have this repeatable process. And the human factor of you know, potentially disrupting that process, you know, by manually promoting something into production, you know, those are the best practices that we, you know, are not the best practices. The best practice is to automate that system and that integration into production so there's no physical human interaction. Humans and the human factor is the number one security issue in any organization, and that could be from just accidental security breaches or security violations to purposeful, just disgruntled employees looking to destroy or just wreak havoc on a system. So if you have those repeatable processes, you definitely reduce risk. The other thing that allows us to do is audit this process, and it's a lot easier to talk with your auditors and say, yes, we have this separation of duties in the form of a separation of a system from each other, and it's traceable, it creates work items we can address, and because of that transparency, we can tweak that process, we can enhance it, and we can do that over time. So that reduces the risk of just adopting some process just for the sake of saying that you do DevOps or growing that process over time and really tailoring it to what the business needs are of your organization.
Absolutely. Excellent. Before we move to the next slide, I just wanted to mention, guys, we have set aside time for questions at the end of today's webinar. We've got about, 10 minutes or so, hopefully, at the end. So if you do have questions, please type them into your participant feedback window, and we'll do our best to have Mark, DJ, or I answer, or all of us answer your questions. I know we have a few already, but please don't wait till the end to ask questions. Put them in now. We'll queue them, and we'll have them ready. That being said, DJ, I believe the next slide is out of your deck as well. But before you do, Mark, I know it's hard with the delay on sounds, and we don't want to step on each other. But any comment you want to add?
Not anything other than I'm going to stay out of DJ's way because he's a master on this stuff. I think that he's actually one of the thought leaders in the idea of end-to-end security right now. So am I going to interrupt what he's saying? Hell no. Go, DJ.
Appreciate that, Mark. So, you know, this slide here is basically the automation of this, and more so how to get started. A lot of organizations come to us and they ask, you know, this sounds great. And how do we start implementing these tool sets in it? And even what are these tools? What are you looking for as a security organization? And these first four bullet points on this slide, we're looking at SAS, DAS, OSSM, and container vulnerability scanning. Those are, you know, I call them the four horsemen of the DevSecOpolis. And when you're looking at these are the first four things that you really want to address. And there are a lot of low-hanging fruit that can be plugged into a development pipeline. And you can do it in a way that's unobtrusive, that doesn't interrupt the development flow. The last thing we want to do is introduce security tools just for the sake of introducing them and not really think about how that affects the productionization of your software. So the first thing on here, we have static code analysis, and this is very important. This is looking at the content of your code base and looking for vulnerabilities that are in there from an introduced perspective. So these are vulnerabilities that could be introduced either, you know, in the past for brownfield applications or for greenfield applications, you know, things that developers are putting in there. Could be injection flaws, could be potential overflow issues. It really could be anything. And so static code analysis is looking for those vulnerabilities and creating work items that people can prioritize and the business can say, okay, we're going to get these prioritized, we're going to get these remediated. Dynamic analysis, this is your attacker point of view. So you want to be able to run these automated scans, and this is almost at a QA phase. So as you're doing your quality assurance, your user acceptance testing, you're running your dynamic analysis against there as well. And that's, you know, looking for the low-hanging fruit from a vulnerability perspective. You can also put an ethical hacking in that kind of stage too, but the automation of these tools, look at the attacker point of view. Open source software management is huge, and it's very important. Mark will be talking about this later in this presentation a little bit. I think it's one of the most important pieces of these pipelines. And the reason why is developers are looking to build applications based on components that they can get off of the internet or off of GitHub. These just give them a jump start, and they provide functionality. And combining these together can put the enterprise at risk, either from a licensing perspective. They could use a component that would instantly open source the application that they're developing, or that open source component can contain vulnerabilities. And that leads us to container vulnerability scanning. And we've probably all heard about the Docker event that happened at Docker Hub. Someone uploaded a vulnerable image that was siphoning off information. And that was just a base image. So anybody using that image, I believe you know, Mark might have the exact numbers on it, but there were quite a few organizations that pulled that image down and integrated that into their systems. So knowing what's in your containers is massively important. And then secondary to that, you definitely want to know if you're using cloud hosting. Oh, sorry. Yeah, secondary on that. Anyway,
no,
that
no, I'm sorry. I'm mumbling.
Oh, no worries. The security of your cloud, the configuration of your cloud is very important. You know, in the United States, for example, the government can only operate in certain regions, or federal agencies can only operate in certain regions of the United States. And having that sort of mandate, and these are, you know, NIST frameworks, FISMA, all these kind of different regulations and different compliance documentation define how you can put things into the cloud, at least from a government perspective. But even from an organizational perspective, you want to know what's out there. I've seen many situations where you do a scan of all the virtual private clouds across your hosting provider, your CSP, your cloud service provider, and you might find somebody in your organization hosting a Minecraft server in Dubai, you know, in a Dubai region or something like that. I'm not calling out Dubai, but it could be anywhere across of these cloud service providers' infrastructure. But knowing what you have out there is very important, because you could have systems that are running that aren't protected and could be a pivot point for attackers in the land and expand model. Infrastructure as code is huge as well. You know, now if you're using cloud technologies and sometimes even like router configurations or firewall configurations, you can do that all in code. Rather than going into an IDE or, you know, even the web consoles of the cloud providers and typing, you know, creating instances and virtual networks and routing tables, et cetera, do it in code, and you can audit that, and you know exactly what's up there. Turn that console off unless it's in a developer environment, so you can, you know, control that end state of your environment. And then chaos, that's something that Aaron Reinhart loves talking about, is introducing a bit of chaos into the system and testing the resiliency of your application. And that's not just a security security type of tool or security control. It just makes sense from a testing perspective, especially in large systems. And definitely don't press the scan button. All these systems provide a plethora of information, all these tools and techniques. You need to consolidate that noise for your business. Otherwise, you're just going to be overwhelmed and your program's not going to be successful. So do these tests, triage the information, get rid of the false positives. If it's a greenfield application, ratchet them all down, so absolutely no vulnerabilities can be pushed to production. If they're brownfield, you can threshold things, and as people check in code that fixes issues, you drop your acceptable threshold, and eventually you get to defect zero, which I've seen a lot of organizations inside the business that I work in right now that have done that and gotten to the point of zero vulnerabilities.
Excellent.
You know, DJ, one of the things that is interesting here, too, is as you're talking about the cherry picking and how to get started, I think a lot of people think they're going to have to rip and replace, which is antithetical to what we're trying to do here. I think that we need to analyze the existing tools that are in the pipeline and then don't replace them, but extend them or find ways to enhance the security of the tools that are being used by the developers and not replace the tools.
Indeed, it's, you know, if you think about a Lego set, all that these tools are is just snapping onto an existing piece of Lego. You're not replacing tool sets by doing anything here. The caution of integrating these tools in your pipeline is that you don't interrupt it and that you don't introduce what we call security drag. So one of the things that we do is time the amount or the duration that these tools run and try to optimize those by doing incremental scans or parallelizing, whatever that word is, but running things in a simultaneous way.
Absolutely. All right, guys, we need to move on because we'll never get through all of our slides otherwise. So, DJ, I believe this is another one of yours, yes?
Absolutely. You know, people here are key because they create that process. They choose the tools. Even though people are also probably one of the number one vulnerabilities because they introduce security risk into the organization, when it comes to that collaboration, I think that's what really is the point of this slide is the communication of these teams. Having security involved right from the beginning of a feature is hugely important. And that leads to the integration. You want to integrate all these teams together, these tool sets that you're using, and you want to make it transparent. You want to be able to get information out of these integrations and make sure that you're optimizing your flow and to keep moving, right? It's to get to the point of having a mature DevSecOps or DevOps process, I don't think people are ever done. And the reason why I say that is you continue to improve. It's an iterative process, and business change, vulnerabilities change, feature sets change, and having the initial or having that in the back of your head that this is going to be a fluid process is something that we need to make sure that all the business knows, from the product owners right up to the executives, that this is going to be a constantly evolving process.
Yep. Agreed. All right, let's move on to our next slide. And with this slide, I wanted to introduce a term that is, very prevalent within DevSecOps, and that is the idea of shifting security left, shifting left. And what we mean, obviously, is if we say, the modern application software delivery lifecycle starts with, let's say, a requirement analysis prior to design. And that starts all the way at our left-hand side. And the software delivery life cycle goes from left to right. We don't want security to be the last thing bolted on at the far right side. We want it shifted left. And as this slide tries to illustrate, the further left we shift security, first of all, the more secure, better quality software we turn out, but also, frankly, from a cost factor of remediation and stuff, the more further left we shift, the more efficient we are. But I have two experts here with me. Mark, you haven't had a chance to talk yet a bunch. Why don't you talk a little bit about the shifting left?
The first time I heard the term shift left was from Gary McGraw. And if you've been in the industry a while, you do know Gary. And it rang true, the idea that what we need to do is to stop thinking of security as a specific single point at the end of the production cycle that needs to happen. And Gary started talking about this years ago, and it started to ring. it's great to see that the industry has picked up on it now as a mantra almost. Last week I had Kaiser Permanente do a presentation which just floored me because the team at Kaiser has moved so far left that they are before the development cycle. What they have done is they set up a simple web page for their developers that has three form fields in it. And what they're doing is they're putting in the name of the open source component they're thinking about using, and it goes out and pulls the information in about that component, tells them whether they should be using it or not, and that's done in the planning stage before they even put their fingers on the keyboard. DJ, I don't see how much farther left you can move than that.
I think you got to move as far left as you can. One of the bubbles that isn't in this diagram is the threat modeling. And it sounds like what Kaiser's doing is threat modeling or in bringing those components into their threat modeling process. So they know what kind of potential vulnerabilities or attack vectors, things that they might need to remediate before they even start coding. And then that gives people a lot of power. It gives the developers and even the business to, you know, potentially modify those requirements for the feature they're creating, or potentially look at a different component, or do a pull request and remediate the issues and contribute back to the community. But I think that each one of these bubbles on the screen, security is part of that, and the shifting left is getting the information, no matter if it's a security issue or vulnerability, or it's just a code vulnerability, a code bug that it has been introduced, like maybe something crashes when people navigate from screen to screen, or could be what, you know, something that there's a JavaScript function that has an error in it, throws an error. Whatever that is, if a developer can address it sooner, and think about this, if you block these kind of things or report these kind of vulnerabilities, bugs, defects earlier in the cycle, and you kick those back to the developer right away, the person who introduced that vulnerability is the person who can fix it, or the person who introduced that JavaScript issue can fix it. They are the person that knows this. The longer you wait, the more technical debt you acquire. So shifting everything left really makes a lot of sense. By the time you get to the production area, you can still be detecting vulnerabilities, issues, bugs, defects, but you want to capture those earlier in the cycle because you end up saving a lot more money addressing it sooner rather than later. It's a very exponential curve. The further you get to production, the more expensive it is to remediate issues.
Fair enough. Okay. So moving, you know, I want to just another diagram that comes from Shannon Leitz and the DevSecOps.org site. Is this, you know, we talked about continuous delivery. People say DevOps is the symptom and continuous delivery is the cure. Well, security, like everything else that we talk about in DevSecOps and DevOps, security needs to be built into there. And I'm not here recommending or endorsing any of the products or open source projects that are illustrated. This is really meant as an illustration to give you a look of what that software delivery pipeline looks like, right? What that factory floor looks like, if you will. Filled in with some of the leading tools that are used for various stages along the way. Again, I'm not saying that there aren't other CI/CD tools besides Jenkins or continuous testing besides Blaze Meter. But this gives you an idea of the kind of tools and where they're used in here. Guys, before I move to the next slide, just Mark and comment on this one or thoughts?
I think it just kind of brings home the idea of what we've been talking about for the last 45 minutes. Is that security has to be a part of every single step in the pipeline. And I learned that from DJ.
Yep. I think we had a question in the audience early on about, you know, where does this fit into the cloud and into the life cycle? And here's a great illustration of it. Okay, let us move on then. And let's talk a little bit about open source usage, and of course, you know, Equifax was the poster child this past year for how to use it in secure open source versus secure open source. But Mark, I know you and the folks at Sonatype and the Nexus community have done a deep dive here, so I'd like to turn it over to you, and we'll go from there.
Sure. Let's give credit where credit is due first. You've mentioned Derek Weeks several times here. Derek helped put together, he and his team put together the statistics that you're about to see here. And it's kind of a warm-up. I've got about four slides here that are part of the presentation that I'm going to be doing in Singapore, so this should just give you a taste of it. One of the things that we do is we are actually the stewards of the central repository. So we have access to the data to know how much downloading is going on and what are the habits of the community. And when you look at these numbers, it is absolutely astounding how much open source usage there is. When you look at the numbers at the top of each of those stacks, those are in the billions. That means that we saw 87 billion downloads from the central repository last year. Next slide, Alan.
Sure.
There we go. When you think about that, why was there so much downloading? 80 to 90% of a modern application is consisting of open source community components. Go ahead, next slide, and it'll bring this one home too, Alan. So next slide. And of that 80 to 90% of operations consist of assembled containers. Since Docker and the container movement came on the scene, now we've got components inside of containers, and we have to build security around that. So the open source download of all of these components are building systems that are held together with a little bit of source code glue is the way that I like to think of it. And now we have to deal with those wrapped up inside of containers. Next slide, Alan.
Sure.
There we go. And I think this is the money shot here. DJ and Alan, I'm going to ask for a comment after this one, though. But when you look at it, I remember the minute I saw what Heartbleed was happening. I was at a conference with Josh Corman in Boston, and Melissa was sitting next to me in the morning that morning. She said, wow, look at this. I can see the traffic that's going by, and she named a bank. And she was watching the traffic that was coming in and out of a bank on her computer. And that's where Heartbleed was. Look at that, 14% of the people in 2014, I'd say suspected or verified something. But look now what's happening. As of 2018, 31% suspect or verified. And you guys both know how hard it is to get people to admit this stuff. So I would think that this is an extremely low number compared to what is really happening. Alan?
I absolutely. And Mark, let's just emphasize, this is just open source defects, right? There's a whole bunch of defects that are not open source. But, you know, the fact of the matter is, and I don't have the number in front of me, maybe I missed it, but certainly 80 to 90% of enterprises today are using, you know, open source components, open source software within their organizations. And, you know, the numbers speak for themselves, 87 billion. And that's, you know, the Nessus repository, right? It is, when I was younger, Mark, it was a cottage industry. It's grown into a fortune, you know, a Dow Jones listed industry at this point in terms of trying to manage this. And it's only going to get worse because now we start piling on things like IoT devices, right, and that kind of thing, where you multiply the amount of software that's controlling things out there. Look, it's a double-edged sword, the world we live in. It's a tremendous time to be alive and enjoy this technology, but it's also very scary, very scary.
Yeah, yeah. DJ, you're going to have a chance to comment on this in Singapore because I'm going to have the whole presentation. I'm going to have you as my right-hand man there. So I'm going to hold off on your commenting until the next slide. We'll see that. Alan, I think I've got one more slide
sure.
left, maybe two. Let's see what we got. This one right here slays me. And when Derek first brought that up to me, Oh, no, that can't be. The framework that brought down Equifax was download. Look at the number of downloads, and then you see the pink where the disclosure was announced. Look at the downloads following the disclosure. That's crazy. So when we're looking at this, what is it going to take for the industry to say, we need a way to determine whether or not we are building safe software? And it's very simple start. As DJ was saying, the simplest thing, the thing that you can cherry pick the most right now is make sure that you're using safe components that have been vetted, that you know are safe to use. It's not brain surgery here when you look at the download numbers here. And I get excited about this, I know. But DJ, you got a comment on that one?
Yeah,
absolutely. This is frustrating for me to see. Yeah, I look at this diagram, and all of this is preventable. You know, it makes sense that people would be using this framework, but as soon as that vulnerability was disclosed and people keep downloading this, it's very difficult for me to swallow. You know, not just am I part of an organization that creates software for individuals and for users, but I'm also a consumer of this software from other organizations. And, you know, when I say that security is everyone's responsibility, it's beyond the four walls of our businesses. This goes out to the world, the enterprises all over the world that are creating software and devices for people to use. IoT, I don't even think that we've gotten close to understanding what kind of vulnerabilities are included in those devices. And I think that that's going to be an interesting place to look at and place to watch in the next from an industry segment perspective over the next couple of years. You know, when you look at open source software, attackers have access to the same software. They can do things. They can look at that software, see where the vulnerabilities are, and before you know it, you're going to be compromised. And if it's a researcher, at least it's a researcher, and there's a responsible disclosure type step-by-step process that you can go through to make sure that before you release this vulnerability to the world and tout that you found it, you disclose this to the organization, give them a chance to fix it. That's just good corporate and world citizenry at that point. But this is just inexcusable. And having some tools and knowing what's in your software is the number one thing you need to know. You need to know what your software is comprised of, and I don't think many organizations can say that they know that.
I'd like to. Slide here to give us talking points. Just the final slide.
Yeah,
we
no,
can
Mark.
Sit on that and do a Q&A.
Yep. Before we do, Mark, I just want to bring this home because I don't know whether people are looking at these slides on their phone, how big it is on their computer, and if they really can see the numbers here. I want to just really make the point. I know you were lathered up about it, Mark, but let me drive it home for you, folks. So what we're looking at here is not the usage of a vulnerable open source component. So in other words, it's not the application that's already released that contains that vulnerable component. We're talking about the download of this component to include it in a new application or the next iteration of an application. And if we look at, you know, the month leading up to the Equifax incident, to, you know, ground zero, if you will, or whatever you want to call it, it was averaging in the high 80s, below 90,000, but between 80 and 90,000 downloads a month. Then in September of 17, boom, you know, we get this ground zero effect. Doesn't go down much then, but, you know, you'd say, okay, people didn't realize. But then October and November, months immediately following, where, geez, you know, the world's on fire around this Equifax thing and what caused it, and we still see barely a blip in the amount of people downloading. Again, not just using applications that have this vulnerability, downloading it and putting it in new applications and new versions. And even in December, January, months, 4 months after the disclosure, we still see it in the 70,000 plus range per month. Not even 10% of a fall off, closer to probably a 7 or 8% fall off. To me, that is not ludicrous. It's asinine, quite frankly, right? And I don't, if that doesn't get your attention and make you understand what the problem is and what you have to do and what your mission is when you go back to your organizations, I don't know what does. Sorry, Mark, I'll get off the soapbox now. Let me go to the next slide.
No, I wish you stand up taller. So this is, okay. I want to put in that you and DJ and I will be in Singapore. By the way, if you don't know Singapore, that is the conference center. We had a wonderful time there last year at RSAC. So we're going to be there again on July 24th. DJ is going to be having a session. DJ, I'm going to invite you to talk at my session at the main conference based upon what we talked today. So we can do that. So with that, Alan, I would say we'll see everybody in Singapore, but we're open for the Q&A now if you want to pop that channel open.
Yep. So, guys, please feel free to ask questions on here. But while questions are coming in, I want to just also mention, in addition to Mark and DJ, I will be presenting there. We're going to be announcing, the Singapore DevSecOps and DevOps community is thriving. As it is, as I said earlier, around a lot of the Asia-Pacific Japanese region. So we'll be announcing in the days and weeks to come, some local folks from the community who will be presenting there. And Mark and I are trying to pull out some rabbits out of from under our sleeves to bring in people on the level of DJ, worldwide experts, to come in and really bring this over the top. Because frankly, you know, as I said to begin with, DevSecOps is a worldwide movement right now, and it's catching fire. And it's as big in APJ as it is anywhere else. So please, if you're in the region, come to RSA conference. Come a day early. Check this out at DevSecOps Days. Let me get a question here. Well, this is a question. This is more of a comment. But why are they still downloaded? It's craziness. That, my sentiment exactly. But I don't know what more I could say. I think I've said it all on that. Let me go to our next question. Are there similar numbers for commercial off-the-shelf COTS products, you know, comparable to the Horizon open source compromise? Are the compromise growing at a similar rate for both COTS or closed source, if you will, versus open source? And that's a great question. DJ, Mark, any answers on that?
Yeah, I believe, you know, I think it's probably about the same. And that's the gut feel. This is where your third-party risk governance at your organizations are going to come in. You know, really, any product that you bring in, you need to scan that the same way that you're scanning your software. There's a methodology called VBSIM where you look at the vendor and you do an assessment of their security posture. Are they doing static code analysis? Are they doing dynamic analysis? And how do they handle security in the organization? Because third parties are a big risk of, you know, for introducing these kind of new vulnerabilities into your code base or even vulnerable systems inside of your walled garden or your walls of your organization. For example, I was just scanning a container the other day that was provided by a vendor, and this image was riddled with critical vulnerabilities that my 8-year-old daughter could compromise. So, you know, it very easily mm-hmm. with some scripts they could find on the internet. And that's unacceptable from somebody who's selling you software for potentially hundreds of thousands of dollars to come out with something that they know has vulnerabilities in it. It's just irresponsible. So, you know, I think that, again, you have to understand what's coming in from an open source perspective, and then look at the components that you're using from the vendors that are supplying these to you and ensure that those don't contain any vulnerabilities either.
You know, that's just,
I wanted to say something.
Right?
I'm sorry, go ahead, Mark.
Yeah, it extends the idea that Devin used to talk about with the supply chain. And the first one is know your suppliers. You have to know your suppliers. You have to know where things are coming. In the case of the question, getting back to the question, though, is open source or COTS more vulnerable in a sense? One of the things we do know that is open source is on the market, so people can actually look at that and they can actually know that thousands of companies are using this specific component and actually build some kind of tool or criminality based around that open source piece, as Chris Roberts would say. So one of the things that is useful to think about is how easy is it to look at these components and get an evaluation of these components that you're using, as opposed to how are you going to evaluate that off-the-shelf software? Now that we know that 80 to 90% of most of the major applications are written with open source software, I would think that you would want to tackle almost immediately the cherry picking parts of the open source. So that's my answer to that question, Alan.
So I will just put the cherry on the top of this one. I've been involved in IT for 25, 30 years, and, you know, I've been involved in the open and security in one or so, a couple of years. Look, open source software is not any less or more secure than you want to call it pods or closed source or whatever. What you do get with open source is because it's open source, we find out when there is a vulnerability, when there is a fix, when there is, you know, an exploit in the wild. So it's more transparent, right? But don't think for a second that COTS or closed source software is any more secure than open source. It's certainly not. They, you know, buffer overflows, cross-site scripting, vulnerabilities, bugs, whatever you want to call them, are prevalent across the board. That being said, we've got a few more questions here that came in, and I apologize. We talked too much. Here's a good question for you, DJ. Can you provide insight into the leaders in the container vulnerability scanning space? And that's a crowded space now. Do these vendors tend to blend SaaS, right, with infrastructure vulnerability capabilities? So static, that is like a Qualys Veracode blend, if you will. Or am I off base on their purpose and usage?
Well, I think there's a couple of things here that you're looking at. Anything that that you're producing in or that you're putting into your software, you're doing static code analysis before you're getting to the container. And that's of the code that your organization is introducing into the product mix of open source components, third-party components, et cetera. So from a vulnerability perspective on containers, you know, that's looking at the components of your layers, your base operating system, your base container, or your base images that you're pulling down that could contain multiple vulnerabilities just by, you know, app getting or pulling in multiple libraries that help that application function. So it's, you know, a couple of leaders in that space, and this isn't an endorsement for any of them, but there's Twistlock, there's Aqua, there's a bunch of different organizations that are looking at containers. You know, even Qualys can look and inspect containers. Sonatype as well, they can rip apart a container layers, look for open source components, and then give you a open source view of that that image and what's in there. And even the command line. You know, Docker inspect, there's a bunch of different container command line tools that you can get in and look and actually see what's in these containers and grep through a manifest and see what's going on. So yeah, there's a bunch of different things that you can use, and some of them do combine different tool sets into one. For example, Twistlock will monitor your host for specific vulnerabilities or abnormal behavior in your Docker engine. It really depends, and you know, each tool is going to offer different features. It's looking at the right one and potentially even combining them all together.
Yep. Guys, we had a flood of questions come in here at the last moment, And this is why I always ask your questions early so we can anticipate and cue the time. We're at the top of the hour. We're going to need to end up. Well, there are a few more questions. If the RSA conference folks can get them to me writing, I'll try to get written answers out to those folks. I like to answer the questions. But that being said, reminder, July 24th, if you're at all thinking about it, come on down to DevSecOps Days. Join us at RSA conference. It's important. It's timely. It's going to be better for your organization. It's going to make you more valuable in your terms of your career. So if we do have anyone listening who's in the London area, next week, June 28th, is the DevSecOps Days London, and you can get more information on DevSecOpsDays.com for that. I think there might be a coupon code even for that one. So check out DevSecOpsDays.com. Great resource. Guys, I wish we had more time for questions, but I've got to be respectful of everyone's time. DJ Schleen, you're a rock star, man. Thank you for jumping in. I know we had advertised John Willis on this, and he had some scheduling conflicts. DJ, as usual, stepped in and saved the day. So thank you, sir, for being here. Mark, what can I say? You're always, it's you and me, riding off into the sunset in Singapore now. We'll be there soon after London. Thank you, everyone, for attending today. Thanks very much to RSA Conference for always being a great host and partner and allowing us to bring DevSecOps Days to the world. And this is Alan Shimel for DevOps.com and Security Boulevard. We'll see you soon. I'd like to hand it back to Erica, if it's okay.
Thank you, Alan, and thank you also, DJ and Mark, for a terrific presentation and discussion. And thanks to all of you for joining us for this RSA Conference virtual session. We do hope that you will join us in Singapore from July 25th to 27th for RSA Conference 2018 APJ. For more information and to register, please visit rsaconference.com. Thank you. You may now disconnect.